What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Suppose we have this car object instantiated using the car class you see in front of you. Now, what we need to do is create an exact copy of this object. So how do we do that? First, we create a new object of the same class using the new keyword. Then we go through all the fields of the original object and copy their values over to the new object. Easy, right? However, if some of the object's fields are private and hence not visible from outside of the object itself, then we won't be able to copy the object the way we did. Additionally, our copying is tightly coupled. It is dependent on the car class itself, since we have to know this class to create the duplicate. And sometimes, if we are dealing with third-party applications or dependencies, we might not have access to the class itself, but only to the concrete objects created using this class. Or some other time, we might know the interface that the object follows, but not its concrete class. Like, for example, when a parameter in a method accepts any object that follows some interface. How are we supposed to duplicate the parameter inside the method if we have no idea what concrete class it is implementing? Well, if you encounter such scenarios while developing an application, then you know that the answer for your problem is the prototype design pattern. The prototype pattern is a creational design pattern that delegates the object duplication or cloning process to the actual objects that are being cloned, without coupling the creation of the object to its class. To apply this pattern, we have to start by declaring a common interface for all objects that support cloning. Usually, such an interface contains just a single clone method. Inside this method, we create a brand new object of the current class and copy all the values of the fields of the old object into the new one. With the help of the clone method, we didn't only decouple the creation of duplication logic from our class, but also we gave ourselves access to the object's private fields, as these fields and the clone method now belong to the same class. Our clients, or the users of our application, can now produce a copy of any object that implements the interface containing the clone method. And every object that supports cloning is called a prototype. What you can see is the class diagram representing the basic structure of the prototype design pattern. And relating it to our previous example is pretty straightforward. As you can see, we also had a prototype interface housing a single clone method. Whereas the concrete prototype class references the car or vehicle classes in our example, or any other classes implementing the prototype interface. The subclass prototype you see is just there to highlight that if the concrete prototype is extended, then it is preferable to override the clone method. Inside the new implementation, we will call the super method and handle the fields introduced by the subclass. Now, before I dive further in this pattern and tell you what a prototype registry is, let's try together to implement the clone method, and while doing that, we will discuss the difference between a shallow and a deep copy. To do this, we have to start by creating the prototype interface and declare the clone method inside it. Now, the prototype class, in our example the car class, must define a copy constructor that accepts an object of the same class as an argument. The constructor must copy the values of all the fields defined in the class from the past object into the newly created instance. If the created instance extends another class, or in other terms is a subclass, then you must call the parent constructor to let the superclass handle the cloning of its private fields. The last step is creating the clone method. This method usually consists of just one line, and it's invoking the new operator with the prototypical version of the constructor we just created. Okay, suppose the car class indeed extends another class, the vehicle class. And this class is also extended by the bus class. Now, because both of these classes already extend the vehicle class and it is an abstract class, we can move the clone to this class and get rid of the interface. But here is actually where the power of prototypes really shines. If our client decides to create a list of vehicles and run the clone method on the objects stored inside this list, even though we don't know the exact objects in the list, the program checks their real class and runs the appropriate clone method defined in that class. The execution of this code will lead to a second list storing exact copies of the vehicles we had inside in the initial list. This was made possible because we moved the instantiation process to the object level using the prototype pattern. Without the clone method, we would have had to check for each vehicle inside the list whether it is an instance of the car class or the bus class. making us dependent to these classes by coupling them to the creation or duplication logic of our objects. In the example we just implemented, we cannot differentiate a shallow from a deep copy, as all the fields of our classes are immutable. Therefore, to tackle the difference, suppose that our car class contains a GPS system object. For the sake of the example, this object will remain empty for now. In the copy constructor we created, if we assign the GPS system object passed to the constructor to the newly created car clone we are creating, then this newly created car will reference the same GPS system object in the memory, and any change done on this object will be reflected in both cars. That is what we call a shallow copy. On the other hand, if we decide to create a brand new GPS object for the car we are creating, or clone the GPS system object by letting it implement the prototype interface, then we will be doing a deep copy, as any change done on the first GPS system object will not affect the second one, and vice versa. Okay, by now you should have a complete understanding of the prototype pattern and should be able to implement it and apply it in your application to clone your objects. However, there is one piece of information that I explicitly left out, but hinted at, and it's the prototype registry. You see, after you clone several objects and make use of your prototypes, you may see the need to store your frequently accessed prototypes, like create a centralized place, a catalog for the prototypes you use and clone the most. This place is called a prototype registry. The prototype registry stores a set of pre-built objects that are ready to be copied. The simplest and most used prototype registry is a string-to-prototype hash map. The registry is typically implemented as a new factory class. Inside this factory, we will have a method that searches for a particular prototype based on a search criterion provided by the client to the method. After the appropriate prototype is found inside the map, the registry clones it and returns the copy to the user. So, as a recap, you should use the prototype pattern when your code shouldn't depend on the concrete classes of the objects that you need to copy or duplicate, as this pattern will clone objects without coupling them to their concrete classes, will get rid of repeated initialization code, and will save resources and time, especially when the object creation is a heavy process to do. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.